Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us. This is a recommencement, I guess, of our speaker series. It's been a while, it's been a few months. There's a lot of legislative action that's sort of kept us busy. And now that people are back to work for the summer, and not that work ever ends in education and education reform, but we're pleased you all joined us this morning. We even splurged for bacon, so if you've been to these events before, it's not always the case, so enjoy. May not be a regular thing, so don't get your hopes up. Just kidding. Hey, we've got a great topic for you this morning, something that's really important. When you look at the things that are critical movers in the education world, you're really going to improve schools. You often hear about teachers, which is absolutely critical. But the very next thing out of most people's mouths are the school leaders. The importance of a high-quality principal, the huge difference it makes, and the huge problems you have when you don't have one. So today we're going to explore a little bit about the school leadership issue, especially in an urban context in Ohio, where we've heard at least, and we'll ask the question soon, that sometimes recruitment can be a challenge. Retention can be a challenge. So we'll talk with an expert superintendent from one of Ohio's big urban districts, Lori Ward from Dayton Public Schools. We'll also be talking with a couple of alternative training programs for school leaders. So we'll have Heather Grant here from Cleveland's Aspiring Principals Program, and Ben Lindy from Cincinnati, who is with Teach for America, and also has an innovative program going on. So without further ado, the way that we're gonna proceed today is I'll talk with Lori for 10 or 15 minutes, want some questions back and forth. And then Heather will present, then Ben will present, and then we'll have just a couple panel questions, and then time for you to ask your questions. So, we will get started. Thanks again for being here.
Indians, you all know what I'm saying. So we really had to really think about how to investment in the district. They knew the district. The hardest thing about to be a principalship in a, I hate to say an urban environment because that just kind of puts a tag on it, but the hardest is to understand the community in which you serve. You know, every schoolhouse has a radius around it. And if you're insulated as a principal and not understand that community, there's no way you can draw the relationships that you need to be an instructional leader, as well as establishing high expectations and a common vision for the instructional staff.
Very good. That's a tremendous statistic, that 71% have less than 3 years of experience. What do you attribute that to? Are those changes that you feel you've had to make to take Dayton to the next level? Or are your principals being poached? Or what is that? Because that, I think that's one of those statistics that when you look at it, it probably was never the intent, but all of a sudden you're looking at that number and thinking, my goodness, that is tremendous, tremendous change point.
Good question. You know, we were hit just like everybody else with the change in the state teachers' retirement system. So we lost several principals through attrition. The other, I always kind of say this, is the we have in Montgomery, Dayton sits in Montgomery County, 16 public school districts. And so you know what's happening to us. It's just a merry-go-round. And so, yes, we are being poached. And we have probably one of the lowest salary schedules. So how do you, if you will, do creative recruitment incentives, send your leaders off to Harvard's Urban Institute? That's a good one to go to. That kind of gets people charged up. And so we've looked at how you put together a package to keep. But I will say this, and this is something I really found out lately and talking to a lot of our young, notice I said young principals. You know, there's something really interesting occurring, and that's called balance. I find more and more young people want a balanced life versus pushing it until 8 and 9 o'clock at night. And I don't know if everybody's seeing that. But you know, I need to get my work on at 5 a.m. and then I want to do, I do a great job, but I'm going to meet friends for dinner and I want to travel. And so in our environment, it's not an 8 to 5.
We certainly discourage it.
Yeah. I came from private industry and I always tell people I never worked this hard at all. But I'm seeing that it is literally about a balance of life that people are pursuing.
That certainly does make it a challenge. I think we all know, we've either seen or certainly you've given indications that being a principal is challenging. When you're talking about recruiting, I've heard you mention the Harvard Leadership Institute and the package you put together. So sort of what does that ongoing support and development look like? Because you're recruiting, you're trying to put together, you're getting the great people, you're spending the time, which may be your biggest investment in recruitment. What is that ongoing support? How are you thinking about what it's going to take to keep them there and help them grow and be successful school leaders?
In our structure in Dayton, we have two chief of schools that supervise the principals. And they put together an annual principal institute, which really is a week-long journey of reflection, development that the chiefs put together, as well as we have another position in Dayton called a senior principal. Senior principals were created a couple years ago when I really tried to figure out how do I keep the great and best principals in the district. And so we have a level called a senior principal that coaches other principals. That became a great motivator because many principals don't want to come to central office. That's like, I don't want to do central office. I don't know what I might join Teach for America, but I don't think I want to do that. But I really want to coach young a lot of retired superintendents across the state that will come in and do a lot of the principal training. But we do like to send principals away in groups, let me just say this, in groups, so that they can reflect and hone and talk about their practice.
Great. I know we've got some policymakers here who have to leave, and I was going to save this question for the panel discussion at the end, but I'll jump it forward, and I'll ask Ben and Heather the same question later. And that is, if there's something about the policy environment as it relates to principals right now that you could change, or that you would recommend being changed, and if you don't have an answer to that, that's okay. But I just wanted to give you the opportunity to make sure that your voice was heard in this respect. If there's something about the principal environment, whether it's salary schedules for principals, principal evaluations, is there something that's not working that can make your life easier as you're looking to have great school leaders?
That's a really good question. You know, we have, I think, I met a bright fellow that's here. I don't know if there's other bright fellows in the room. From a policy standpoint, good intentions, let me say good intentions many times have unintended results. And principals are spending enormous time on the Ohio teacher evaluation system. And then if you have new teachers and resident educators, it's really crazy. And I really, really think that if we look at, and I know that there is, you know, policy change as far as accomplished and skilled and the frequency by which, but I think that really the whole process of the evaluation system truly, truly needs to be looked at. I think it's cumbersome. I think that for the results that you're trying to get, which is really evaluations are done for three purposes, and only three purposes. The first is when you have to really look at an individual who's really in play and just wants to grow in position. So how do you just continue to evaluate to develop? The second, of course, are your stars that you say, I'm going to evaluate because they can achieve higher levels in the organization. And the third is when you have to coach an individual out of the organization. So that's it. And to tie the complexity of tying student achievement so deeply, and I know changes have been made, I think is something that needs to be looked at. The other thing is programs like the Bright Fellows are excellent. I think that well done, but you know what? We have even principals, assistant principals in play that really should have great opportunities like that. And we need to look at our internal structures and figure out how the internal structure of policy changes can be affected so that we can keep the best and brightest in our system. I would say that. I would say all principals deserve more money. But it is extremely hard to affect that at the policy level, if you will, Chad. So those are, and I feel very strongly that the evaluation system is the right way to do it. I just think that how it is designed is very cumbersome. Teacher leaders will look at really what principals do and say, I don't want to do that. Why not?
You know, I'll end with this question and we'll bring up Heather and Ben to do their presentations. When you're talking about teachers, and I think a lot of us have heard those stories where a great teacher is then automatically, if they want to make progress in their career, they're made to be a principal. And so sometimes you're losing your best teacher. Sometimes they become great principals, but other times they may never get their footing. So as you're looking at that and evaluating that, what are your cues? What is it that makes you think, or how do you weigh that? Losing a great teacher in the classroom, which is invaluable, versus the potential to get a great principal that could coach 20 or 30 teachers.
We've lost so many great teachers in Dayton. I sit and struggle. struggle, but our highest performing school in the city, and that's overall big public schools and charters, is Skyver School for the Arts. They are a nationally known system. The principal, the sitting principal in that building has been the principal for the last 13 years. Okay. When she was faced with this onslaught of teachers because of the change in the retirement system, she knew, and it's like anything else, you talk about poaching. The best and brightest districts come and get our best and brightest teachers, right? And so this one young lady, teacher leader, exceptional AP teacher, she said, you know, I know she's gonna walk. So she said, Superintendent, I got a plan. I don't want to share it, but will you support it? And you know that's a tricky question. So like, okay, I trust you, fully trust you. She took this young lady, she has two sections of AP, and the rest of the day she coaches the 17 new teachers in the building. She is loving it. And because that's what she wants to do. So I think that we have to, you know, really kind of look out of the box when you have those great teacher leaders that, and I see them all the time, they do not want to aspire into this world of principalship. Some don't even want to go to central office. So how do you take their day, if you will, and let them coach other teachers? People always tell me, what's my definition of a master teacher? And, you know, it's easy to sit there and say, well, what's his or her results look like? There's way more than that. It's the relationship with students, and it's relationship with parents, and it's the relationship and the influencing that that person does with the other faculty in the building. That's the master teacher. So I'm on board with that, and I want to see more and more principals make designs like that and not fall into the trick bag of taking your friend who's not the master teacher and doing that work.
Kudos to you for giving that principal the flexibility to keep a great teacher in the classroom. All right, I guess we'll now move to phase two. So thank you for hanging with us. Get another slice of bacon. We can't take it with us. And Heather, please come up. The PowerPoint is all yours.
Good morning. Thank you. I'm Heather Grant. I'm pleased to be here today. I'm from Cleveland Metropolitan School District. I'm the director of the Aspiring Principals Program and New Principal Support. We're in year two of our project. We have started an out-of-the-box program to onboard new principals for our school district. To give you a rough idea, in Cleveland, we have approximately 100 principals. And this year alone, we hired 25 new principals. So this is a great need for us to have change agents to increase student achievement and bring change to our school district. Today, I want to go over with you a little bit about our program, an overview of what it's about, who we're looking for, and give you some updates on how we're doing so far. So we have our program because we want to increase life opportunities for our students in Cleveland, right? We're here for the kids. We want to make sure our leaders are here for the kids. We believe that skilled leadership and passionate school leadership is our key to equity and school transformation. We ask all of our leaders to be the change, right? We don't want you to keep status quo. We're not expecting you to just keep on doing what's always been doing because that's the way we've done it and that's just okay. It's not okay. We need change. We want to have transformation for our schools. And a lot of this comes from our legal plan, which was ground-sweeping legislation that brought transformational change to our whole city, not even just to our public schools, but also our charters in Cleveland. And you can check out more of that, what the Cleveland plan is, on our website. We have three phases to our program that lasts 14 months. All of our aspirings begin with a five-week summer intensive. When I mean intensive, kind of like principal boot camp for them. And I'll get more details about that. Then they go into a year-long residency with a mentor principal. And it's not about the school match, it's about the mentor match, because we want to make sure that they have the right mindset and the right fit for that leader. It's based on their areas of growth, the aspiring areas of growth. And then also during the residency, I not only coach them, but I also facilitate their a weekly cohort class with them based on our standards of our program. Then, for the first year, as they transition, hopefully to get a principalship, because it's not guaranteed, we have first-year coaching support with a one-on-one coach. Well, they have a couple new principals that they coach, but they have weekly coaching, as well as monthly professional development for myself. So this is a snapshot of just what the residency looks like. We're currently in residency right now with our aspirants. For our mentors, we have this. In the summer, I identify a pool. I basically do strategically reach out to some of our most transformational leaders who I can count on to mentor an aspiring principal. They learn about the goals for each one of the aspirings, and each of the aspirings come up with their own leadership goals. We facilitate their learning so that they're very reflective leaders. We make mentor-mentee-masters over the summer. Then during the school year, I visit them monthly and check in with the mentor as well, because when I go to the school sites, I'm not just developing the aspiring principal, I'm also developing the mentor so that they can help guide them, because they're with them every day in the school site. Also during the school year, we have a switch month, which the aspirings, once they get like their sea leg, right, they think they've got it figured out. Then I switch them and I make them go to a different school site to get a different flavor, because we have a portfolio district where we have many different options of our schools, and we want them to see different leadership styles, different school portfolios, so they can learn different leadership. Also then, during the year, again, I'm meeting with them regularly to make sure I'm developing the mentor and the mentee. So our approach to our program is problem-based and action learning. I bet we could all say that we didn't learn everything we know from school, right? Just because we went to school, came every day, did great, you could write great papers, we read great theory, didn't mean that you learned everything you needed to know for your job, right? We learned a lot from action learning, hands-on learning. That's what our program really thrives on. We want to give them real-life problems and real-life scenarios that principals are going to deal with. We're not just going to talk about it, we're not going to just fishbowl it in class, even though we do those things. I want you to live it and breathe it, debrief with you, reflect on it, how you're going to change your leadership, and what you learn from that. So we want to make sure that we're offering this hands-on learning for them. We know that adults learn by doing, right? So we want to make sure that they're getting that best experience in this year-long residency to get them to be the best principals we can have. Another big approach to for our program is feedback. If you are not able to receive feedback in our program, it's definitely been a struggle, and has actually been termination points for our principals. We want to make sure that they are getting this timely feedback from the summer, as well as through their areas of growth, where we're asking them to reflect on what their area of growth is, to make sure that not only is it, that's not just me saying, well, what do you think it is? Well, what are you working on today? What leadership are you still developing? That they're able to self-reflect and realize what that is. Their mentors also work strategically on those development areas. I can tell you, for example, one aspiring this year is like, I'm going to go around and introduce myself to all of the classrooms, to the students. I said, why would you do that? Well, it's personal. It's a great way to do that. I said, is that your comfort zone? Or is that an area of growth for you that you should come out and speak to the whole group, to the whole school? Oh, you're right. I shouldn't do that, because it is comfortable for me to go to all the classrooms. Right, so you doing that is keeping in your zone, right? We want you to step a little bit out to grow and stretch. So we are constantly talking to them and coaching them, giving them that feedback so they understand what they need to do to grow. Again, I visit them in the residency school, and I also have them every Thursday for cohort sessions. They have assignments. Assignments are actually the real work of the principal. It's not just writing a theory paper. Or something, I would do this, it's a reflection on something, they have change projects, they do teacher observations, and we're practicing for this multi-step evaluation process. And all of our feedback is low inference. So what we mean by that is just what we see and what we hear. Maybe what we didn't hear, what we didn't see. Instead of just saying, you know, that was bad. We don't want want to speak in that world. It's very high inference. We want to give them exactly what we noticed, what we saw, and ask them to reflect too, as well, to understand what they see with themselves. So our approach is always standards-based. It's not personal, where we get into, oh, she's really good, or he's really good. We want to make sure that we understand it's all about our standards. We have clear standards that, from day one, that they're speaking about, and we get them versed in. And for example, yesterday when I was on a school visit, I always ask the aspiring, what leadership standard are we working on today? And at the end, I always have them self-reflect and a self-assess as to where they thought they were on the spectrum of our performance and our criteria. So they are always looking at themselves and their own work to see where they are for their leadership standards. All of our assignments and our work are aligned to our standards, and our coaching is also throughout the standards as well. So here's our standards. We'll take a look at those. Wanted to keep it to 12, something manageable. We're looking for their personal behavior, keeping up with ethics and legal requirements that we have. Also just their interactions with people, their resilience is extremely important as a transformational leader. Their communication for different audiences. Students' performance is key as we're using data to make decisions and always focusing on students' growth. Situational problem solving, like what you do within the situation and how do you always assess your environment. Continuing to learn and moving on through. Now we're talking for the on the right side, how you are supervising adults, bringing change, working on your school climate, your time task management, which is key as a new principal. They tend to like to do everything, and I have to be in charge of everything, where we're working on delegating skills and supervising others, and then of course using technology. Some of the work that we do in the summer intensive, these are some of the assignments and some of the work that we go through, and then in the residency. In the summer intensive, they actually have a scenario school. Maya Angelou K to 8 is our scenario school. We actually use the data from one of our schools. And we practice looking at their data. What do you do? How do you work together even as a team? We work in a team all the, as a cohort. We have two teams, and they have weekly reflections and a project team manager and coordinator, and they work with each other, give each other feedback. And I'm constantly assessing to see, will they have those hard conversations with their own team that they're counting on for the work? We have literature connections where we're studying literature, of course, during the summer, and then throughout the year, they do progress reports, they present to families. I run many scenarios for them in the summer where they're meeting their teachers, they're meeting their superintendent, and we have many different things that they're working on. They create a vision for their goal and then a professional development plan. Now, the residency, we do focus a lot on teacher performance and how do you assess teacher performance, how do you go through a pre-conference, a post-conference. Progress monitoring is very big if you're expecting principals to make change. How do you have your goals for your school year? What are you working towards? And then how do you progress monitor those goals? And you're constantly working on that feedback and collecting that data. One of the hallmarks, too, of the residency is the compact, where the aspirants come up with their own leadership activities that they know they need to work on based on their areas of growth related to the standards. So we make sure that it's almost like an individualized learning plan for themselves as to what they're working on for their leadership. And I'm constantly talking to them about that when I'm observing that. This was not just our idea in Cleveland. It has been adapted to us, but we work closely with the New York City Leadership Academy. They are a proven partner in these action-based, outside-the-box leadership development plans. Some of the other districts and cities you can see that they're working in. They've been an absolute support and joy to work with. They've also worked directly through me and with me. They don't just tell me what to do. They give me the framework of the program, and then we've adapted it to us, and I meet with them monthly, either WebEx or face-to-face. So, if you think that you would like to be inspiring, or you know someone, this is what we look for in a candidate. We look for someone who is committed to social justice, right? We want to make sure that we're here for the kids and that you're committed to a strong sense of change and social justice for our students. We expect them to have a strong instructional knowledge, a desire to lead a hard-to-staff school, right? We don't want to just say, yes, I want the best school in the city. I think I'm that type of leader. No, we have a whole other pocket that we've been held to the state, of course, to bring change, and we need you to go to those schools, right? Would you like one of those schools? If they say no, I just literally pass them through. Pass them over. I won't even consider them. We're looking for strong resilience and integrity. We want a strong reflection and self-reflection, strong communication, and we have to have relentless drive to be a principal, particularly in an urban district. And I'm looking for experience and evidence of that they should bring to us, and then also that they say they want to do for us. So again, aspirants, they have to commit to 5 years of work in CMSD. They also have to have 3 years of teaching experience. Other leadership programs that are similar to ours don't require teaching experience, but we do. It's best for our community and our culture, and also for the instructional knowledge that we want them to have. We require 3 years. We do ask for a master's degree. It's easier to get an alternate principal's license if they don't have one already. And their year one of residency does count as one of their years of employment. So our applications, they come out in January, but we did get it in earlier this year. Last year we had 184 applicants. I interviewed 65 of my team, and we chose 10. We have 10 aspiring principals. They do get paid a salary, $75,000 with benefits. And here's a little bit about how the employment details work with the application. There's an extensive essays in the application. If they pass through that rubric, then they come for a group interview. I facilitate that. There's fishbowl style, where I have colleagues who are versed in our program and our standards to observe them. I'm looking for key qualities that I would have previously. They have an individual interview and then a data analysis. So it is a rigorous interview process to get in. So the other big piece is, this is not a guarantee. You do not get a principalship just because you've made it through the program. And I can speak to that for sure from last year. In addition to going through this year-long program, the employment process for principals is very similar to the aspirings. Again, another application of essays. Online teacher observation, they do complete a mock teacher observation. They give feedback to that teacher electronically. And then there's a phone interview. We follow up with them to ask them questions about it, their goals, what they noticed about the teacher, what they might change. And then also, of course, the in-person group interview, the individual interview, and they also completed a data analysis. Reference checks, of course, for a principal, and of course, with firing. But then the final stop for a principal went to interview with our CEO, Eric Gordon, our CAO, Dr. Pierre Reed, and our Chief of Talent, Laura Cover. So currently, last year I had 10 aspirants. Again, we started out with 10. I did dismiss two during the year because they were not making progress, even with support and embedded intervention plans and reflection. They were not making progress. That was best. I knew they wouldn't make a principalship, so it was best to stop that then, mid-year. Six of our aspirants last year were hired as principals and two as assistants. And I'm also currently supporting them as new principals this year because I also support new principals. I feel very, near and dear to them. I love them dearly. But I told them, I will always keep them very hard to the line because I have very high expectations of them. And I'm expecting them to bring change and increase student achievement. Also, for this year, we have 10 aspirants and one has been dismissed as well this year. So we have 9 currently. So of course, even though we have all these wonderful things set up and we want to have this great support, bring new change agents to Cleveland for our principals to better our students' lives, we want to make sure it's actually working, right? We don't want to just do this to do it, even though we want this. We want different change agents and leaders. This year, we're going to measure then those 6 principals, have their graduation rates improved if they're at high school. We're looking for increased academic growth on state assessments for all their increase teacher and student attendance rates. And we're looking for our leaders to strategically go to schools that are priority focused or six schools for our district. That is definitely the measure that we want to make sure they're in a very high need school. That's our aspiring principals program. I hope that you found that helpful for you to understand how the program works. And I can take questions now.
We'll let Ben go next.
I'm very sorry.
We'll give them a chance to ask questions.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Ben Lindy. Thanks so much for having me, Chad. Really excited to be here. I thought I'd start just by introducing myself a little bit so I'm less of a stranger and share a very quick presentation about some work we're doing in Cincinnati. I'm the Executive Director of Teach for America in Cincinnati and Dayton, Ohio. From Cincinnati originally, and I was a teacher with the Teach for America program in North Carolina in 2003. I taught for 3 years, two at a district-run public school and one at a charter public school. Worked for the DC public schools and their Office of Human Capital, so this idea of how do we find great talent for district schools is something that's close to my heart, and that was after law school. And then I've been with Teach for America for the last 4 years. I'm excited to be here. Real swiftly, if you aren't familiar with Teach for America, the problem that this organization is trying to solve is this issue of educational inequity, which I think is an issue that brings a lot of people to this room today. The idea that still today in 2015, the neighborhood where a kid is born is still overwhelmingly determined with their long-term options in life. And so these are figures from the communities where we work, my team across Dayton, Cincinnati, and Northern Kentucky. But you can see that most of the kids growing up in poverty just don't have access to the same kind of educational options and outcomes that kids growing up in higher income communities do. And I just say that for me, when I look at these figures, this to me is not a reflection of kids' potential. I think kids growing up anywhere have enormous potential, and equal potential, I'd say. I think our problem is our systems. I don't think this is a problem of bad kids or bad teachers or bad school leaders. I just don't think we've set up the systems that we need to make sure all kids have access to an equal shot, which is what Teach America is trying to help do. And to do that, we need two things. We first find very talented, often young, committed, passionate, diverse people to serve as teachers in low-income public schools for at least 2 years. So we do this in Cincinnati public schools, we do this in Dayton public schools, we do this in Northern Kentucky. And the second thing we do, which people sometimes know less about, is we support our alumni, so people who have done those 2 years of teaching to go on and become leaders in lots of different parts of our education system. I mentioned a second ago, I think this is a systems problem. I think the best contribution we can make to solving that problem is through systems leadership. So we want our people who have had this experience of teaching in low-income school to become school principals. We want them to run for school board. We want them to work for districts. We want them to serve as impactful leaders in public education in our state. And so that brings me to this particular initiative, which we started in partnership with Cincinnati Public Schools a year ago, principals. And you'll see that Teach for America has had some success across the country in being a source of school leader talent. And I chose two examples here, although there are at this point over 700. One of whom is a guy named Mike Feinberg, who's the founder of the KIPP program. He was a school principal in Houston. And folks may know the KIPP network is one of the most successful charter management organizations in the country preparing kids from low-income communities for college. So Mike, incredible principal from Teach for America, but also lots of district principals, so not just charter schools, which is why I chose the Brett Kimmel example, who has been the principal of a school in New York City. This has also led kids to some pretty profound results. So for several years, Teach for America has been helping alumni from the program become really impactful principals. We just hadn't done this in Ohio. So our partnership with Cincinnati Public Schools looks a little bit like this, and I'll talk through the diagram in a second. But where this came from was a conversation between the superintendent of Cincinnati Public Schools and myself over a couple of years, where she was sharing that one of the, it sounded a lot like Superintendent Ward, one of the most impactful positions, in her opinion, is the building principal. And what could a strategy look like to find increasing numbers of very talented, committed folks to serve as school leaders. And so we cloned this program in Cincinnati from a program that our Teach for America region of Indianapolis runs. Where the basic idea is Teach for America, my staff recruits alumni from around the country to apply to be a principal. And to do this, you know, we set some requirements. You need to have at least 4 years of teaching experience in a low-income setting. And we put together a pool of candidates for the district of America. We recruit nationally for this. The district then interviews the pool that we put together and picks the ones that they want. This last year, our agreement was for two principals. So CPS picks two of our alumni that they want. They spend two summers at the Columbia Teachers College Summer Principals Academy. So they're in New York City, and they're in a summer program that is designed to train principals for low-income schools. In this interim year, they do a residency as part of the Columbia program with a Columbia mentor, but they do it in Cincinnati Public. And so they serve as an assistant principal in CPS as training and part of the program to get to know the community in Cincinnati. So then following that second summer, they begin as a principal. And so our pitch to our alumni is, hey, we will offer you a free master's degree from Columbia University in school leadership and a principal credential. We'll give that to you for free if you commit to at least 4 years as an administrator in Cincinnati Public Schools. That's 1 year as an AP, and then at least three more years as a principal afterwards. And what we found was that that pitch let us go after a group of candidates that was pretty impressive, and that I think they're going to make over the next couple of years a big impact. I'll tell you a little bit about how we thought through this strategy, too. We're very new in Cincinnati and Dayton. We just started our fourth school year. So if you look at our alumni, the oldest alum from our region in Cincinnati and Dayton really only has 3 years. And that's not a great pool to find principals. I don't think they know enough yet. I don't think they're far enough along in their career. But if we look nationally, and if we say, okay, who are people who, maybe they're from Ohio, or from Cincinnati or Dayton, did Teach for America somewhere else, have been teaching for 5, 6, 7, 8 years, and maybe at a point in their life where they want to move back home, but they want to stay working in education in a place that matters, we found that numbers are a lot bigger. And so this was our sweet spot in terms of our recruiting. And so we found two people for the first cohort that I think are pretty impressive. Both grew up in Cincinnati, and they fit this profile, right? Both grew up in Cincinnati, both taught with Teach for America, but taught elsewhere, one in Baton Rouge and one in New York. Both have been teaching for many years, and they've been teaching in one of the other top performing charter management organizations across the country. This one was Uncommon Schools. So Nina Giannacchio was a founding teacher at an all-girls charter school in Brooklyn, taught there for 5 years and was a teacher coach. That's after fulfilling her Teach for America commitment in the Bronx. And Amanda taught with North Star Academy, which is the flagship high school for the Uncommon Network in Newark. So both of these alumni have taught in schools that are just exceptional. And they're bringing that framework, that frame of reference back to Cincinnati. So these are our two in our first cohort. We're in the process of recruiting two more for next year. So if you know folks, let me know, we're very interested. So a little bit just about Uncommon Schools. They are concentrated primarily on the East Coast. You'll see just some enormously impressive results around high school graduation, SATs, college attendance. And folks may have heard of Teach Like a Champion, the book by Doug Lamov. That's a book that came out of the Uncommon Schools Network. So we're excited about bringing them to Cincinnati. The one area where I was not happy last year with our recruitment and where we're doing some work to get better this year was on the diversity of our candidates. Both Nina and Amanda are wonderful teachers. They're also both white. And you saw on that first slide that 77% of the students that our teachers and alumni serve are children of color. And I think it's very important that we recruit a leadership force where kids can see themselves in that leadership force. I think that's an important thing that we need to do. And so we're taking some steps this year to increase the diversity of our group, which I'm excited about. I also would just mention here that this compares that group of 300 on the previous slide to 300 fellowship eligible alumni. That group is about 19% people of color. And if you look at our 2014 core members, So these are teachers with our region in Dayton and Cincinnati, you know, in their second year. It's 49% people of color. So Teacher America, we've done a lot of work over the last 10 years to try to diversify our core members. And what I'm excited about is if you forecast this across the next 4 or 5 years, I think the group of principals that we're going to recruit is going to get far more diverse because the base out of which they come is more diverse as well. So we're at a point where we're in our ninth week of this. So we're not very far in. We don't have a lot of results yet. What we have are people that I think have a lot of potential in a program that I think has done well in Indianapolis, another mid-sized Midwestern city. But I think the real test is going to be how our student outcomes from the schools where Amanda and Nina are eventually going to become principals. And for the district, we did our initial funding campaign for this. We funded two cohorts of two fellows each. So we're funded this year and we're funded next year. And I think one test will also be, is the district interested in renewing that or growing that in future years? So thanks very much for having me. Excited to be here and excited to take questions.
Great. So what I'll do now is, Ben, you want to go ahead and see you over here. Thanks, Lori and Heather.
Thank you for your time.
So I'll start us off by asking a couple of questions, and then I'll turn it over to you. And if you don't have questions, then I'll keep asking more until we run out of time. So, you know, Ben, you highlighted this issue, and I think all three of you did. So I'll start with this, because you mentioned it just right at the end. Talk to me about the ideal candidate and the role of diversity. I know you each touched on that, but I think it's an important reflection, and it's something that doesn't always get the attention I think that it deserves. So how do each of you in your role, respective roles, think about that as you're looking to staff, especially since I think, Lori, most of your teachers happen to be white, I believe you said, and a lot of your alumni are, and you know, so your applicants might be skewed. So how are you balancing this? It has to be an incredible challenge.
Yeah, thanks for the important question, Chad. And I'll share just a couple things that we're doing. Because I think that the issue of diversity matters in a lot of different ways, some of which get talked about frequently and some less frequently. The one I mentioned initially was just the composition of the principal fellows, how many of them are people of color. And I think that matters a great deal. But I also think there are other ways in which diversity matters from a pedagogical perspective, which is to what extent are the principals and the teachers able to make the school a place that is a culturally responsive one, one that lets all kids feel at home, and one that creates a vision of academic success that embraces and honors the cultures and traditions of the kid, rather than asks them to exchange where they come from for something else. And I think that's really important and really tricky. And for us, the two things we're doing this year is being more aggressive about recruiting on the front end applicants of color. And so trying to find, one thing I love about working at Teach for America is we have pretty good data on those things. And so we have 42,000 alumni around the country, all of them take a survey every year. And so we know of that group who qualifies for our fellowship, who's interested in becoming a principal, who is a person of color. And we're trying to be much more aggressive about getting in front of the people of color who could apply, not just looking at the ones who do apply. So we've explored ideas like having a recruitment weekend in Cincinnati, where we offer to fly out to Cincinnati 10 people of color who haven't even decided that they're going to apply for the program. And if we get two of those people to apply, one of them becomes one of our two principals for this year. That's a big deal. So we're trying to get more on recruitment. The other thing I'll mention is selection, because you can get a diverse group of people to apply, but then they may not make it through the selection process depending on what you're looking for. And so we're trying to build, in partnership with the district, a screening process that is more, I think, thoughtful about looking for culturally responsive leadership as a non-negotiable for getting in. And we'll see if it works. I mean, we just kicked off this year's recruitment campaign 2 weeks ago. Applications are due in December. And so I would just plug again, a fantastic teacher in my mom who could apply for our program.
Let's talk. Great. Lori, Heather,
well, let me just say, course, I would love to have leaders that look like students in the building. However, the traits simply are this. Cultural awareness of children living in high poverty. And I say, I say high poverty instead of, is significant. And I believe you can be white or black to understand it. Now, you might need some coaching, but to be sensitive to the culture that you serve, I think is one of the greatest challenges, is you have to mobilize that faculty to step out into that neighborhood. And that can be quite scary sometimes to faculty members. But if we're really going to make an impact and improve student outcomes in the urban centers, you've got to have leaders that can work the neighborhood, the faculty, motivate people there. And I think, personally, you can be white or black. I will say it's all about income, though. So let's not be fooled. If I am growing up in an environment where a child of color environment where my parents, grandparents, I had some support, believed in me, chances are I'm not going to pursue the teaching profession. Okay? Chances are, and we know that, and we should all know that about our students. And so how do you motivate your best and brightest, if you will, chemistry students to become a chemistry teacher in a public school system or whatever it may be? So I would just say that it's about understanding the children and the families you serve. And I'll take anyone who can do that effectively and lose student outcomes.
I agree with my colleague that screening for diversity is extremely important. We do want our students to see themselves in positions of leadership, educational leadership. But I also agree that it doesn't matter if you're black, white, whichever, as a person, it is about how you receive and accept students and just people in general. And I also think it's very important that as a leader, that you understand your own biases, your own mental models, and how that could come across in either leadership decisions or how you choose to tackle a situation or not. That can say a lot, and to me that would also keep the status quo, which is exactly what we don't need for urban education.
All right, this question will be for Lori. You're being flanked here by a couple of folks involved in alternative leadership programs. I imagine some superintendents will have a very mixed view of whether that's necessary or whether the traditional method is either working fine or is enough. So sort of, what are your views? I know you mentioned the Bright Fellowship earlier. So what are your views about the importance or unimportance of alternative leadership programs and what you see as their potential?
I have a mixed view. You know I have a mixed view. So, truth be told about Cincinnati Public Schools, they invested heavily on the University of Virginia model. I don't know if everyone knows that was merging the School of Education and School of Business together, because the thought process was that an effective principal is really running a small business. And so how do you merge that together? I think that there are people who want to change career. I changed careers and came to the world of education. That you can, with the right supports, if you will, build leadership around if that person is effective. I just haven't seen enough of that. And I really, really believe that an effective instructional teacher has to have that instructional leader has to have that classroom experience, at least that moment that you had at a teacher where you moved outcomes of a child that has low self-esteem, that somebody gave up on, and you said, I did it. And I think personally, I think faculty members want an instructional leader that's been in the war.
pretty well as well. So how are you thinking about that? I know, Ben, it's just 9 weeks in, you may or may not be yet thinking about what continuing ongoing engagement and training looks like. So how are you each thinking about this? We'll let Heather start first.
First, I want to say I was a traditionally trained principal. So coming in to lead and facilitate, to be honest with you, an alternative program was an adjustment. And it's not because I wasn't willing or interested and open to the idea. It's once I learned that, we're learning through experience, right? We're doing all of the work of the principal. We will have theory, and we do have papers and all of those types of things that almost make us feel comfortable. But it's about that hands-on work, that trial by fire that you learn the most. You actually get to apply the model's work. You get to work with Paul Maverick's Antonio's driven by data. You have to actually do it. You can't just read it and then write about it and talk about it in class. But for ongoing support then for our principals, I do think that it starts from day one of understanding that as a principal, I'm a former principal myself, it's very lonely where you're the lead person to be the business person in charge, the boss of everybody, and you don't always get to say, hey, I really need to talk to you about this. Or, do you understand what I'm talking about? This is my context. So one of our strategic moves for Cleveland is that you have a cohort of support, our PALs, we basically refer to them as. And we thrive with that by, even in cohort, having class meetings and how we help each other and who can you reach out to for that when you're struggling with this issue. We also have, during the residency, myself going into the school, I do the weekly class with them. They also have their mentor each day that they can talk with and reflect with and they observe, or the mentor observes them. But then once they get a principalship, that whole summer, our principals work all year, we have that onboarding support where I also created, separate from the Aspiring program, a 5-week support. It's almost like a new principal boot camp as well, where we're meeting with each other once a week. We're designing our introduction plans, how you're meeting with your councilman, your union rep, to your parents, everyone, down to learning about how our student code of conduct is, how our CBA is. We have a lot of professional development in onboarding through the summer. And then through the year, we have coaching. We've invested, we have two coaches, retired principals, who go into the schools either once a week or the other coach goes in every other week to coach the new principals on their leadership standards, the OPEZ standards for new principals. So it's very important to give principals support, and we're actually looking to give beyond year one. We've gotten a lot of feedback from our principals. They find it very rewarding and necessary. Again, so we can build that community of support as principals for each other.
Thanks very much, Chad. It's a great question. I think, so my experience has been, and I appreciate everything the folks who came out of Chad telling me it was great, is that although coaching and support ongoing is important, it can sometimes overlook the importance of recruitment and selection on the front end, and that there are at least people important, and that finding the right person in the right seat, you can't skip that part. And if you do that part right, the ongoing coaching and support you need, there's less of it. And if you don't do that part right, it doesn't matter how much coaching and ongoing support you have, because it's not the right person to see anyway. And so we've tried to align our principal fellowship to that model, so that most of what we're doing is around recruiting a diverse and competitive applicant pool, running a selection process that's rigorous with the district. And then when you get to the ongoing support part, our approach so far has been to make sure that there are three points of contact for the fellow. One is they have a mentor through the Columbia program who's there for ongoing support. It's somebody who's been a principal, it's somebody who's come through the Columbia training program and knows what the person's coming through, so that's point one. The second one is they have a peer who's going through the program at the same time, so they can rely on each other a bit. And the third is the district. Since
I have plenty more bang-up questions, but I would like to turn it over to the audience if you have any questions, because I know we're running a little bit short on time, and I want to get you guys out of here on time. But if you don't have a question, then I'll pose my own. Okay, Lisa?
Is for Superintendent Ward. You talked about homegrown teacher leader programs. Can you tell me more about those?
Sure. The principal I mentioned over Stiver School for the Arts, she's a senior principal, so she has developed a very, very effective, efficient teacher leader program. So like CMSD says, aspiring, we call them teacher leaders. And it's an application process. She has a team that vets all the applicants. And then she actually sets up all the professional development working with the University of Dayton. And that's been highly, highly successful in our assistant principal ranks. So she does that in addition to coaching other principals.
Thank you. A follow-up question. Is there a stipend associated with that teacher leader program?
For the teachers themselves, yes. They actually have a stipend. Actually, it's no cost to them. We actually send them to one selected professional development program that the principal selects as a cohort. Mm-hmm. So they go, so they look forward to that one. And majority of all of their work is done on Saturday. Actually meet on Saturdays.
Thank you. I have another question for Heather. And Heather, you talked about the summer intensive program. How was that paid for? How was that funded? The 5-week intense summer program?
Our aspirings are paid for by the general fund. Okay. And so their first day of work is July 1. So that's part of their 5 weeks, and it's before the school year starts. And then for all of the curriculum and everything, my salary is actually paid for by a grant. So I'm facilitating that, designing the curriculum, pulling in the resources, designing the assignments. So the resources that we have to pay for, I'd say during summer intensive is not very much, just books. So maybe a few $1,000s for the textbooks. But other than that, the biggest cost would be myself. Let's pay for it.
Questions? All right, so I'll wrap it up with one last one, and then we'll get you out of here on time. So this is for everyone, and I think in the education reform circles, one of the things you always hear about is the things that are debated is the ability of a principal to have the autonomy to actually be the school leader. Wrapped up into that is building your own staff, having your own assistant principal. So I guess all three of you may present a different perspective for the alternative leader training programs. How important is that? How does that influence your training, if that either does exist and is a reality, or if it's not, given the current framework and structure your principals will go into? And of course, Superintendent Ward, just your general thoughts on that as well, how much autonomy you're able to give the principal to shape his or her staff. Okay, whoever wants.
I was just having this conversation. So the Lord before me midst of all of this, and that stands in a way of a lot of decision making. But more the more you raise student achievement, then the more authority you have over your building. That's the concept that I have. And I don't think that, sometimes I really struggle with that, but priority schools are really tightly managed. Selecting teachers, I think, should be a part of any leader's program, but we still do have, in Dayton, Ohio, a principal does not have all of that authority based upon the collective bargaining.
Thank you.
Our principals in CMSD do have autonomy under the Cleveland Plan that I mentioned earlier. Legislation that was passed here in Columbus for us to have some of that authority. I do agree, though, that the lower performing the school, they do have many requirements, and they should, because we need swift change, and it increases student achievement in those schools. However, we believe that CMSD, the principal, knows what's best for their school. They're living it, breathing it, and we don't want to have the top-down decision-making. I guess I represent one of those central office people now that we would have called and said, hey, you're losing this many teachers, or you're gaining, or this is how you're going to spend your money. And as a principal, you were held to that. And we want principals to make effective decisions. So part of our training program, using data to make a decision, doing what's best for kids based on the outcomes that you need to achieve. We have a lot of great support for that, for those ideas through our central office. Now we've become an agency that's supporting the school, supporting the principal, instead of them reporting to us.
Finish this off.
Sure. So just acknowledging the fact that I've never been a principal, so there are some real limits to my perspective in this. All I'll share is that I've seen great principals flourish in many different kinds of settings. Some in charter schools where they have near total autonomy, budgeting, hire, all those things. But also folks like the Brett Kimmel example I shared in the presentation. There are examples of Teach America alumni who have been phenomenal principals in districts with collective bargaining agreements and lack of autonomy. So I don't think that autonomy is a sufficient condition for an outstanding school. I just think the skill set you need is different. So as we've worked with CPS to figure out who could be great fellows in this program, you know, we have conversations with them about, you know, people who can build coalitions and people who can build great relationships with others and find ways to get to know and motivate their staff when working with the system has and that starts built into it. I think that, again, autonomy is probably not a sufficient condition. It may make some things easier, and it just dictates which skill set we're looking for.
That's great. Well, thank you very much, and thank you for joining us today. Thank you, panelists.